Okay, so here I am in what is on my way from Cartagena to Medellin, and gonna chat to you a little bit about my trip from get my mirrors right. Watch the potholes. My trip from Panama on the Star Rat to Cartagena, which is a pretty cool little trip. I should have adjusted my bag back there. I can get a good look out of my rear vision on my left side. So myself and about, let's just say about, I think it was about 14 other bikes. We caught the Star Rat, which is a ship, a sailing ship, 114 years old, I think. Sailing ship, big metal sailing ship. It's owned by a German organisation. It's a not-for-profit enterprise, and it's pretty much, you know, one of the only ways you can get your motorbike from Panama to Colombia if you want to go from Central America to South America, because the Darien Gap is pretty much it's not passable. So yeah, we started in Panama. I met a couple of the guys. You know, the one surprising thing is I've hardly met anybody on this whole trip. I've hardly seen any adventure riders, you know. I thought I would be seeing them everywhere, but I've hardly seen any of them. All these towns have little speed bumps in them. Jeez. What have we got here? Oh, I'll get around here. Yeah, they just get through this area here. They've got some trucks. It's pretty typical little small little village. On the way, people trying to sell their fruits and vegetables and some fried foods and meat on the side of the road. Watch out, puppy. Yeah, so we started, you know, I met my first group of adventure riders, a family. I think it's called threemonkeycircus.com. They're pretty cool guys. And they were traveling with their daughter, who I think is around 14 years of age. And I think, if I can remember her name correctly, and I apologize if I can't, but I think it was Georgie. So I met them at, I think it was the El Salvador border. And so that was the first real adventure rider I met that was traveling. And you know, that's crossing Mexico, Belize, Guatemala, Honduras, into El Salvador, the first people I met. You know, I'm really surprised. I thought I'd met a lot of adventure riders. But anyway, so I met them there, and in the next border crossing, I met a guy named Onor and his partner. I can't remember her name. She's a really nice lady. And they were traveling there, traveling as well. And then I met a guy named Eric at on the border into Panama, and we rode together into Panama in pretty shocking conditions, like just torrential rain for hour upon hour. And yeah, that was pretty adventurous, that one. That was pretty much the only rain we had, and Panama was pretty much, that's all it did, was just rain the whole time. And I mean torrential rain, where you could hardly see. You know, I stopped so many times on the side of the road because I couldn't see 50 yards in front of me. So we decided that we'd, you know, the Star Rat, when, you know, they send a group email out to all the riders and where they're going to meet, where you should meet before you come, so you're all riding together. And we all riding together, and I had a pretty big accident. Not a big accident, but I had two rim punctures on the Honduras border, the worst roads I've ever seen in my life. Pretty scenery. And my rear rim was damaged pretty badly in two places. Where I got some help from locals, and I mean, everyone was just quick to help and help me out and get the bike back on the road. And but I had two slow leaks, and basically I had to organise to get. I'm just going to take this truck. Make sure he's got. I've got some space here. That's the beauty of having 160 horsepower and 1300cc engine on this KTM 1290. I'd organised already to have two new tyres in Cartagena. I had to organise a rear rim as well, because I just didn't feel comfortable riding with that damaged rim all the way south. And the guy, Bill, and that from, Bill particularly from KTM in Miami have helped me out tremendously, and I got a few extra other things sent to me as well. A new tank bag, because the zipper on my tank bag was just shot. It was just getting frustrating. Couldn't open it, couldn't close it. I bought the same tank bag, which I don't really like doing if something fails after a year. Yeah, I don't really feel comfortable giving that company money again. And KTM don't make the best tank bag on the planet. So yeah, I sort of tentatively took it from Panama with a group of 14 riders, and it was a pretty good fun ride, and it was a really challenging ride, you know, through the mountains, lots of twisties. Took around about 2.5 hours, one of the guys actually is a piggy. One of the guys actually came off his bike around the corner. Someone braked in front of him and he just lost it and went into a ditch. Did not see that at all. That was not a good one. We'll take this one a bit easier. That didn't feel really good at all. That maxed out my shockers then. So I wasn't concentrating. Here's another one again. They sneak up on you, these things, and some of them aren't signs. And that first one, that was a ridiculously steep one too. It can cause some damage. My rear wheel was pretty much worn to the bone. Feels like there's another one here too, no? My rear wheel was pretty much shot. And then I had a problem going from Panama to El Poño, I think it's called, where we were getting on the ship. My front wheel was leaking a lot faster than was previously. And actually, I'd lost about 20 psi of pressure, so pretty much halved from 38 to 19. And the bike was, the roads were really slippery. And the bike, you know, with all the weight on it, it just didn't like it going downhill. I was trying to use my rear brake and use the gears to slow down, but I was still slipping and sliding a fair bit. But it was a bit of fun. I mean, it wasn't that bad, but I'm not the most experienced rider on the planet, so it took everything. And even one of the guys said, "Geez, I kept saying, I don't think you should be braking here." Where I was braking, you know, I was braking about halfway down a mountain. It's not the ideal place to brake, you know, coming into a corner. But and then just trying to drop the gears on it as I came into the corner, but it was still sliding a bit. But anyway, we finally got there. We lost one of the guys, Eric, the guy that I met. He was at the rear and I didn't even know. And we stopped and they said, "Oh, I don't know where he is. We lost him, you know, about half an hour, 45 minutes ago." Shit, you know. And he ended up getting there about an hour and a half after, about an hour after we'd loaded all the boats and loaded all the bikes on the boat. And I'm just trying to work out if they're going to have any more of these bloody speed bumps. Yeah, so he got there about an hour and a half after we did, after the boat had already gone offshore after it loaded all our bikes, and I was really worried about it, but he didn't seem too fazed when he got there, and they loaded his boat. They came back and loaded his boat on a bike on their boat. It was pretty good, and so the ship normally has a 5-day trip, and where you stop off at all these islands each day, you only do short amount of sailing each day. I mean, if you went straight there, you could probably do it in 2 days quite easily. We had some really good winds too behind us, which the Captain Ludwig, who's quite a character. The Captain Ludwig said it was pretty rare that we had the wind behind us. So the sails were up, you know, at night. The first night I slept downstairs, and it's reasonably comfortable. It's not nothing, you'd have to say it's like dormitory type style accommodation. But the second night, and you know, one of the guys from the UK, Sam, ended up vomiting his guts out all night, and Eric as well had a rough time the first night. I was fine. I haven't got seasick since I was a kid, so I don't know whether I'm a bit lucky or whatever, but I do know that if you do get seasick, going down underneath the boat, it's not a good idea. That's what a couple of the guys did, so that would have just prolonged it. But the second night, I decided to sleep up on the deck and on a hammock. Unfortunately, someone had already got the hammock before. There was about 3 or 4 hammocks on there. They were all taken by the time I got there, and I slept on a deck chair to begin with. And then one of the guys got sick of the hammock and went somewhere else, and I jumped on the hammock for a couple of hours and slept there. But it was comfortable. It was beautiful, you know. It was great sailing, and we had some dolphins following us in the first night, and Sam got some great video footage of that. I didn't even notice what was happening. There was a few guys at the front, bow of the ship. And I'm just being really wary of any speed bumps. So by the second night we were outside of Cartagena, and so we've left on a Monday, and by the Wednesday we're in Cartagena. Unfortunately the guy who had organised all, see what the Star Rat does is they organise everything for you. They organise your, you hand them your passport and they organise all your import documentation, everything. So it's a, that in itself was worth a fair bit of frigging coin, as far as I'm concerned. Here we got an ambulance wanting to get by. So they organise everything for you. So you, before you go, you send them your documentation. They organise your outgoing permit, closing off your permit in Panama, and stamping your passport. And then they organise also your import permit into Colombia, which is friggin' fantastic, you know. Makes life so much easier. I mean, that's 4 hours just there, you know, conservatively, or 3 to 4 hours anyway. Coming up, thank you. Well, the road's pretty rough here. Once we got into Cartagena, and unfortunately the guy had organised all our documentation into Colombia, it looks dangerous this, but it's not, everyone's used to. The guy who'd organised everything had passed away the night before, the Tuesday. Apparently he'd been fairly sick for a while, and he's pretty old. But it's just the same, it's a pretty sad thing that happened. But that delayed us for an extra day to get our bikes off the boat. So we got into Colombia, and then we took a few of the bags with us, and then came back the following day. They sent the dinghy out and they put us back on the boat again. I mean, I had a really good time. I thought the food was really good. The crew, there was 4 crew. Ludwig, I think he's his girlfriend. The she didn't seem to do too much. Really smiled. I didn't really talk to her at all. There's another girl named, I think her name was Vicky or Nikki. She was from Germany. These are all volunteers on the ship, and I doubt Ludwig's a volunteer though. So the food was great. You know, that a few people complained, or one person complained how the staff were really mean, but I mean, I don't know. Well, yeah, it's pushing it a bit too far. You know, I didn't pay for the smiles, so. But the guys, all the people on there, there's people from Turkey, Israel, Italy, Switzerland, UK, US, Australia, myself, and yeah, they're all pretty good guys. And you know, okay, a couple of them I'm going to be, there's German, German guys, well, a couple of them I'm going to be, you know, hopefully catching up with along the road somewhere. There's one guy who used to be a superbike racer who's doing a venture trip on his GS. He's pretty good. He's a pretty cool guy. He doesn't say much, but he's pretty funny. Well, I've got to turn left up here. So yeah, no, it was, I really enjoyed it. And the food the first night, the locals from the San Blas Islands came and bought on a like a bucket full of just lobster. Okay, I think I'm going left around here, am I? What the fuck am I doing? Sorry about that. I'm just gonna get around here. So my GPS is telling me what to do. So we got into Colombia the first night, didn't have our bikes. The second time we went out, and then we got onto the boat and then sailed out to, or under power, we didn't have the sails up, to a port, which is about 45 minutes away. And then we all got on our bikes, got some photos. That's beautiful, isn't it? Got some photos, and then we all went our separate ways. Chris and Sam, Chris from the US, and Sam stayed a couple of nights. We stayed a couple of nights together at my Airbnb before they got going. And I stayed in the Columbia for a few extra weeks. Got my bike fixed. It took them about 9 days all up from when they got my bike to fix it. And they made a few basic mistakes. They don't have the same sort of gear, but KTM is pretty well represented here in Central and South America. Army boys. There's a nice little road. I hope Elijah can find this all the way. I doubt it. So I stayed a couple of weeks, stayed at a place called the Las Americas. It was a resort type thing, swimming pools, spas, all that sort of stuff. Thought I'd have a couple of weeks there while I was waiting for my bike to get done. Got a few other things delivered to me from a friend in Miami. And so now I'm back on my way again. I left Cartagena this morning at about 5 a.m. and I'm on my way to Medellin. So Colombia, I mean, Cartagena is a must go to place in Colombia. The old city's pretty spectacular. There's a cathedral up on the mountain, which has got some great views, but nothing special. But yeah, you got to learn a few tricks when you... I mean, if you want to be a tourist and go and have dinner in the old town, have at it and spend your $20, $30 on dinner. But if you want to be a little bit smart, what you do is you just go outside of the walls and you get yourself a good dinner for a couple of dollars, you know? Where am I going here? Through here. Sorry. Here we go. Yeah, so you just get yourself outside of the walls of the Alps and get into the streets, and the street food is phenomenal. Lots of meats, chicken, polo, pork, all these things are pretty popular. You just got to be careful when you go around corners in these countries, because always try to sit on the shoulder, because cars overtake other cars in these countries. It's pretty crazy, but you get used to it. Yeah, so you get outside of the main city, you get yourself a great meal for a few dollars. If you want to sit inside the wall, you can get the same type of meal for, you know, what you pay in the US, $15-$20 a meal. Now obviously their rent's a lot more expensive in the old city than that, but still it's a lot of money to spend. A lot of money wasted, really, considering the cost of food here. But the food on the street food here is spectacular. Yeah, you want to have tacos, and you want to, you know, just the carne, the meats and the pork. Chicken's great. You know, even in small towns, you can stop off. Someone will be selling some stuff on the side of the road. Just go for it, you know. The salads are all very basic, but I love it. It's spectacular. So the roads here in Colombia, so far, they're all over the place, you know. You'll get some little potholes, you'll get a couple of large ones, but for the most part, they're pretty good. The worst country was probably Honduras that I've been to for the roads. And parts of Guatemala were pretty bad too, just with potholes, you know. Yeah, it's these sort of things, and sometimes they've just, you know, there's a big pothole that's being worked on. Here we go. Oh. So you just got to be always aware. I'm about one gear out by then. This is typical. This is the typical sort of highway in Central America. People all selling their food, and you just got to not be scared about it. It's good food, and it's, you know, I mean, they make some great ceviche here too in Colombia. Colombian ceviche is pretty much all prawns, but you just got to tell them not to put the sauce or the mayo on them, because they love putting sauce and mayo on everything. Ketchup. Yankees call them ketchup. So yeah. Cartagena, must-see city on your travels. Back this guy. And now I'm heading to Medellin. It's a long, long drive, but I haven't ridden for a while, so I thought I'd give my ass a bit of a workout. And do, like, it's going to be about a 12, 13-hour day. I was going to stop at another city on the way, and for a night, but I just decided to hot-foot it because, you know, I'm getting behind, and I've stayed probably 4 or 5 days extra than I wanted to in Colombia. I mean, I'm in Cartagena. I mean, the thing is, I'm working while I'm doing this, so I don't really, you know, sometimes I've got to stop when I didn't want to stop and work, and, you know, most nights I work 6 or 8 hours some nights, you know. Try to work early in the mornings, and then get myself good out of sleep. So I do a little bit of touristy stuff, but my sightseeing's mainly on the bike, and I like it that like that. So yeah, so I'll talk to you a little bit later on once I get into the mountains. Coming through here, a reasonably small town, but larger by the standards of the villages here. There'll be a speed hump up ahead. Crappy bit of road. Come on, what the fuck are you doing? Locals? So, you know, this is typical sort of scenes. Is, you know, everyone's getting about doing their business. You'll see a lot of these motorcycles are taxis. They're little taxis for locals. Everyone gets about, and you know, I've always said that if you're going to be poor in a poor country, be poor in the country. Don't be poor in the city, because it's a miserable life in the city, because you need money every single week, every single day to live. Well, if you live in the country, you can get by, you know. You can grow your own produce, you can trade produce, you know, like the old days. Doesn't mean you can get ahead, and the city probably gives you a bit better of an opportunity to do that. However, it's pretty stark, you know. The opportunities are pretty thin. But for the most part, I find that people are happy, you know. I mean, I'd rather be poor in a country like Colombia than poor in a country like America, where, I mean, if you're poor, you're more than likely to live in a city, and you have to work probably two jobs, 70 hours a week, just to put food on the table to survive, pay your rent, that's it. Pretty shitty. And there's nothing any political party can do about it. You'll probably be a bit better off if you're from the left, but if the left are in power, you know, the right wing seem to want to stop, you know, all of these social sort of programs. In some cases they've got some points, but most of the time they just want to cut it and spend more money on rubbish like the military, where you're basically just pissing money into the wind each and every year. Yeah, the downsides, as you can see here on the left, is just the amount of rubbish in some places is just terrible, you know. And most of these countries in Central America, with the exception of Nicaragua, probably Nicaragua and Costa Rica, where they seem to have some sort of sanitary programs. Colombia do too in the cities, but they're still pretty dirty. I mean, Cartagena is really clean in certain areas, but if you get into the poor areas where the tourists don't go, it's not. It smells, the rivers smell, they're full of plastic and stuff like that, which is really, really sad. You know, if they're ever going to step out of this, they've got to get systems in place for this, you know. Pretty busy little town. We're probably up about 1,000 meters now. It's noticeably cooler, although I'd still sweat here. I sweat everywhere. As you can see, your taxi's full, a little kid. Village. You know, someone's making plastic, probably melting down plastic chairs. Use to sell the plastic. Oops. Wouldn't hurt to get in gear. Okay, so hopefully this road is a little bit better. Another thing you got to learn is idiot. There's a time to fill up. You'll find that Colombia is pretty good and Mexico is pretty good as far as fuel, depending on your tank range. I've got a big tank in mine. I've got an 8-gallon tank pretty much. But you'll find that you've got to get in the habit. Like when I lived in the US, when I was in the US, should say, I still lived there. I was pretty bad. Like I used to wait till the tank got really low, and then I think, oh, I can squeeze out a few more miles, and I never run out, but it got pretty low. You can't afford to do that in these countries. You basically, once you get under half tank, you've got to fill up if you see a gas station, a service station. Yeah, so you sort of learn to get into the habit of that. I started doing it in the US when I started traveled from Miami to LA. I decided that I've got to get into the habit, and you know, a couple of times I got out of it, and even in the US I nearly ran out of petrol. I had warning light on for maybe 30 miles, like empty, naught kilometres left, and I thought, I'm not doing that again. Yeah, so you got to get into that habit. Fuel's about the same price in the US, all throughout Central America. It's one of the number one ways the government taxes its people through their fuel, because they're definitely not getting taxed out of people selling their shit on the street. That's a sort of a modern type cemetery. Most of them have got those friggin' ridiculous houses. I know that they're important to the people burying them, but I mean, some of them are like 5 metres by 5 metres. The majority of them take up about that amount of space, and they build little buildings with them. And I mean, you know, it's just not sustainable, you know. I mean, just think about it. In 100 years time, there'll be, in 70 years time, there'll be 6 billion dead people. Anyway, a lot of the trucks and buses have like religious or football, soccer, sort of designs on them. This one's got some sort of angel with a sword. It's very angelic, killing something. So you get all types. I'm going to have to just sit behind this. I think there's some road work going on here. I don't know what's going on. Anyway, we'll chat a bit later. Pretty amazing, eh? Monastery on the river. Mary watching over. I thought she'd be pretty busy, but so we're up right up the mountains now, and it's slowed right down. Lots of trucks. I just went past about 20 of them. Front tire pressure's down to about, what is it? That is just spectacular. Postcard around every corner here. Just the thing about it is, you can go wherever you want to go for holiday. A lot of people just stay at a resort, which I did for like 2 weeks, and they don't leave the resort. They don't see the country. Oh, I've been to Colombia. But my God, it's a beautiful country. And I've only seen about a half. It's all red clay. I'll take a photo here. Pretty amazing. And then the cows. Let's overtake that bloody truck again. Well worth a photo. Unintentional speed up. when they do that. Truckies are the best, you know. If you get a car going slow, they don't really care that much. Truckies are always thinking about other people, for the most part. See some crazy ones too. Okay, I'm going to just have some fun now. Sign off. Catch you later. Sorry, I just keep having to put the camera back on. It's so beautiful. Climbing higher and higher. See if we can take these two trucks out of the way, out of the equation. Going to happen sooner or later, somebody comes around the corner overtaking another car around the corner. It's happened a few times for me. Oh God, that's beautiful. You're right, buddy. I can take this off. I don't need much room with this thing. That's the beauty of having a lot of power underneath you. When you need it, it's there. I rode a GS800 in Puerto Rico, and it was a nice bike. It just didn't have the power when you needed it though, especially with my weight and height, you know. Oh my God, that's beautiful. I want to stop every five minutes. But it's been a long day though, and I've got 100,000 mountains to climb between now and the finish. Faster if I wanted to, but it's nice and easy. It's fun the way it is. Pretty much getting closer and closer to the peak here. Trying not to brake at all. Just trying to, no rear brake, no front brake. Nice even road, nice sticky road, you're fine. Let's take my part of the road, man. I nearly touched the road there. Okay, so this is probably one of the most spectacular. You look at the views over that side, and then have a look at this city.
Look at that. Spectacular. Every country I go to, I think, well, I can't get any better than this. And then see views like this. view. High up the mountains. That's a curiously placed, that. Look at that. It's freaking magnificent. Absolutely magnificent. This place is so beautiful, seriously. That's just absolutely spectacular. I don't know if you can see what I see. I'm not going to come out the same. That's beautiful. It's been a great day's riding. 1 hour to go, or an hour and a half to go. We've got 40 kilometres and it says it's going to take me an hour and a half, so I'm assuming that the traffic is pretty bad up ahead. Or it's really twisty like this. I've made good time, like I've pretty much stayed, I've had about 6 breaks so far. One unscheduled with that death of that poor kid, or poor guy, poor girl, I don't know, I couldn't see whether it was a guy or a girl. I'm assuming it's a guy because most, nearly all, not all, but a lot of the riders are, the vast majority are men, and they're probably not as good a riders as the women are. You can overtake, I don't care, I'm just taking my time. I'm going to get there before nightfall, which is good, or just on nightfall. It's going to be nice. So far I've ridden 11 hours and 23 minutes today. That's a lot of riding. And I'm, you know, it's been 3 weeks since I've got in the saddle for this long, for any length of time, and I'm holding up pretty well. I'm not the biggest, I mean, this is not an ideal situation to ride through mountains. Stuff going on everywhere. I'll have a peek. There we go. Thanks, buddy. But it is beautiful riding, and that sort of makes it even better. I think if it was just 12 and a half hours of straight highway, I'd have dumped my head in. But no, it's been good. Hopefully I'll get there in one piece, and the bike, you know, that front tyre still, you know. You spend a week in a workshop to get the front tyre, the rear tyre replaced. You'd think they wouldn't. It wouldn't have a leak, you know, and it's not the slowest slow leak either. I mean, we're talking about 1 PSI an hour. I mean, that's very noticeable. I mean, any leak's noticeable if they do if they put it under the pressure they need to put it under, and put it in water and do the testing with it. Look at this. I mean, seriously. I mean, these are people's lives. He's a bus driver and he's got 10 people in the bus. And this just happens all the time, you know. This guy's under pretty heavy brakes. And you know, you can get away with it 999 times. The thing about it is it only takes that once. God, that's beautiful, look at that. There's a city down there and everything. Amazing. And the thing about it is all those cars, in about 10 minutes I'll have caught up with them all. Hello, son. Nice to see you again. Now I'll get a good look. Anything coming? Oh, okay, not a good look. How easy does it? Oh, it's spectacular. Quite cool up here actually, but it's nice. I like riding. I mean, I've got Klim Overlander gear. I've got the Klim Badlands as well, but it just would have, I mean, it's bulletproof as hell, but it's just so hot and heavy, you know. I just thought I'd bring this with me instead, and I'm glad I did, I can tell you, because I sweat like a bastard in this as well. I'll make my way down the mountain, and then the final video will be coming into Medellin. Hope you enjoy.